illustration of the method of consistent deformation for pin jointed plane frames will be the topic of this discussion. Well, we can see here a pin jointed plane frame over here. There are three supports and there are several members over here. These are the external forces acting at the joints P1, P2, P3, P4 are vertical forces acting at the joints on top of joints, and P5 is a force horizontal at this joint. Well, we can see that this stress is statically indeterminate, and the degree of static indeterminacy, if you count that, that would be 3 plus 2, it would be 5. You can go for the equation, find out the degree of static indeterminacy. This will be 5 in number. If you remove a member from here, a member from here, and a member from here, and one support from here, and one reaction from here, this structure is going to be statically determinate. So the number is, I'm sorry, not it is not 5, but it is 6. 1, 2, 3, plus 2 reactions, plus 1 more reaction. That becomes 6, not 5. You can see in this figure, to say F1, F2, F3, which are the axial forces in these three members respectively, R1, R2, the reactions at this support, R3, the reaction at this support. If you remove these many number of forces from this structure, this will become statically determinate. So now, as it is given here, if you choose this as a choice of remnant forces, we can find out them by applying the method of consistent deformation. We go ahead. The compatibility conditions are written straight away. Sigma I is equal to 1 to number of members, capital F, small f1, L divided by AE of the ith member is equal to 0. To understand that, to appreciate that further, let me reproduce the truss over here. Yes, this stress, there are forces here, like that, P1, P2, P3, P4, P5. The force in any member, let us take any member, say like this, as the ith member. The number of members is going to be counted from 1 to M. So I stands for any one member. The force in a member, let us call that as Fi, is equal to the force in that member due to the externally applied forces on a statically determinate truss, that is Fi prime. If you remove these three members, this support and one reaction from here, the truss will become statically determinate. So the force in a member in that truss due to the external forces alone is denoted as Fi prime, plus the force in the same member due to one of these unknown forces, let us say it is denoted as unknown force is denoted as F1 over here. So the force, say F1, which is the actual force in this member, which is unknown already, into the force in this member due to a unit point force applied along this F1 direction. Let that be, say, small f1. F1 is a
force in this member, ith member, due to a unit point force applied along one of the unknown forces. Let that be F1. So if F1 is a force due to unit point force, the actual force due to capital F1 in this member would be equal to that small F1 multiplied by capital F1. Similarly, if F2 is the second unknown force in this member, which is removed only, and small F2 represents the force in the ith member due to a unit point force applied along F2. The force contribution to this member by F2 would be small F2 into capital F2. Similarly, this member is removed. The force in that member is unknown. We call that force as capital F3. Small F3 represents a force in ith member due to a unit point force along capital F3. So small F3 into capital F3 is going to be the contribution of force to the ith member due to F3. Now there are reactions. They are, say, R1, R2, and R3. So the contribution from R1 would be, let us treat that as small F4 into R1, small F4 into R1, where small F4 is the force in the ith member due to a unit reaction in the direction of R1, plus small F5 into R2. We can explain that in a very similar fashion, plus small F6 into the third reaction, R3. So the force in a member, in the ith member, is defined in terms of, say, seven terms. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 terms. Out of them, the first term is the force in the member due to externally applied forces in a statically determined structure, and the rest of them are due to the unknown forces, F1 to R3. And now, the compatibility conditions would be the total elongation of this member, or the total elongation of this member will be equal to the separation or coming together of these two joints. Elongation of this member is equal to elongation or shortening of that member is equal to the coming together or closing together or separation of these two joints. That is a compatibility condition. Similarly, we can find out one compatibility condition from here, that is closing together of these two joints will be equal to the shortening or elongation of that member. We can find a third compatibility condition from here in a very similar fashion. Fourth one would be the vertical movement of this joint is equal to zero. Fifth one would be horizontal movement of this joint is equal to zero. And the last one would be horizontal movement of this joint is equal to zero. Once you apply all the constraints, these are going to be the compatibility available from geometry. So those compatibility conditions are given using these equations over here. This equation, sigma I is equal to what the number of members, capital F, small f1, L divided by AE, is the total elongation. Here, F1 is the force in a member due to a unit point force along R1. So, in that case, this equation is the total vertical deflection along reaction R1 is equal to 0. That is this equation. Total vertical movement of the joint, this joint is equal to 0, is this equation. This equation is, yes, the horizontal movement of this joint is equal to 0. This equation is the horizontal movement of the third joint is equal to 0. This equation is the elongation or shortening of this member is equal to the closing together or separation of these two joints. And there are two more equations for the other two members. So these are the compatibility conditions. Now,
sigma I is equal to 1 to m f f1 l divided by a. This is actually available from the unit load method. There is a method to find out the deflection of truss joints, that is the unit load method, which is going to be discussed as part of the next section. So once you solve for these compatibility conditions, we are going to find out finally R1, R2, R3, F1, F2 and F3. You can see that there are 6 compatibility conditions and you can form 6 independent equations. So solving all those 6 independent equations together will supply the all these unknowns R1, R2, R3 and F1, F2, F3. So once we do that, we can recalculate the force in a member using the same equation. Okay, that is illustration for a plane joint, for a pin jointed, say plane frame.